Hello, and welcome to Scod Podcasting Radio. This is another Scodcast, digging up old Scod hits from the past. So, I even found an old Bog Peeps Party random recording, as well as all kinds of mixes with Sharpest Sword, AMM, and others. Please enjoy.
Stepping into the woods, Jared felt a slight chill. The air was different, full of the smell of green things and fresh dirt, but the light was murky. He and Mallory stepped through the tangles of jewelry and past thin trees heaped with vines. Somewhere above them, a bird started calling, making a harsh sound like an alarm. Beneath their footsteps, the ground was slick with moss. Twigs snapped as they passed, and Jared heard the distant sound of water. But there was something else, too. Things moved in the grass, in the trees, things he couldn't quite see but was aware of for the first time. Faces made of bark and rock and moss that he only saw for an instant. It was as though the whole of the forest was alive. There. Mallory fingered a broken branch and pointed to where clumps of ferns had been trampled. That's the way they went. They followed the trail of smashed weeds and snapped branches until they came to a stream. By then, the woods had grown more shadowed, and the twilight sounds had increased. Tiny green and brown creatures were perched on a branch. Their wings resembled leaves, but their faces seemed almost human. Instead of hair, grass and flower buds grew from their tiny heads. Come on, Mallory's voice was almost pleading. I can't see what you're talking to. Have you seen my brother? Jared asked.
Perhaps. How are you doing today? Hello, and welcome to the Scod Show. This is the first ever Scod audio show, episode 1, an introduction to the Sustainable Cooperative for Organic Development by your host, Drogo Empedocles. I am Drogo Empedocles, and tonight I'd like to talk about reasons for founding Scod, Scod chronology, and general info about our members.
I gave you a mission, and that is to make apple pie news.
Like,
did
you bring this over before?
Yeah, that's what I brought. Like, if you sell that, it's like, it would sell how crazy though. Like, if a bartender could make anything, if a bartender could make anything nearly that good, it would be like an instant hit, like probably worldwide.
Anxiety and mood disorder. Anxiety,
it's an apprehension about a possible danger.
In some cases, panic attacks can lead to agoraphobia. Agoraphobia is a fear of crowds or a fear of public places, and that may be combined with a panic attack. And people with agoraphobia, sometimes if it's severe enough, end up being homeridden. They stay home, or they're out their grocery, or they don't cross their front door for months at a time if they have a severe form of agoraphobia.
Country Gardens, Garden History, written by Catherine Aalto. The Natural World of Winnie the Pooh, exploring the real landscapes of A.A. Milne's 100-acre wood. This is SNOO, New News. Interview with General Braggart. Peace versus war, which is better? You decide. Welcome to SCOD News. The date is March 10th, 2017, and this is an SNU SCOD News update. My name is Dr. Robot Shitforbrains. SCOD Economics. Slay the hoarding dragon. The rich will be resistant to paying more taxes towards a more egalitarian system, even in the future, just as any hoarder will be resilient to giving up their collections.
The Wonderful Wizard of Oz. Dorothy lived in the midst of the great Kansas prairies, with Uncle Henry, who was a farmer, and Aunt Em, who was the farmer's wife. Their house was small, for the lumber to build it had to be carried by wagon many miles. There were four walls, a floor, and a roof. When Dorothy stood in the doorway and looked around, she could see nothing but the great gray prairie on every side. Not a tree nor a house broke the broad sweep of flat country that reached to the edge of the sky in all directions. The sun had baked the plowed land into a gray mass, with little cracks running through it. Even the grass was not green, for the sun had burned the tops of the long blades until they were the same gray color to be seen everywhere. Once the house had been painted, but the sun blistered the paint, and the rains washed it away, and now the house was as dull and gray as everything else.
Ne. Carlos, vulume, proseche, isvoli, esto.
Orthos, pan, oro.
Metaleps, tireftis, vuforvos, vritomos.
And they were gray also.
Thin, gaunt, and never smiled now.
When Dorothy, who was an orphan, first came to her, Aunt Em had been so startled by the child's laughter that she would scream and press her hand upon her heart whenever Dorothy's merry voice reached her ears. And she still looked at the little girl with wonder that she could find anything to laugh at. Uncle Henry never laughed. He worked hard from morning till night and did not know what joy was. He was gray also, from his long beard to his rough boots. He looked stern and solemn and rarely spoke. It was Toto that made Dorothy laugh and saved her from growing as gray as her other surroundings. Toto was not gray. He was a little black dog with long, silky hair and small black eyes that twinkled merrily on either side of his funny, wee nose. Toto played all day long, and Dorothy played with him and loved him dearly. Today, however, they were not playing. Uncle Henry sat upon the doorstep and looked anxiously at the sky, which was even grayer than usual. Dorothy stood in the door with Toto in her arms and looked at the sky too. Aunt Em was washing the dishes. From the far north, they heard a low wail of the wind, and Uncle Henry and Dorothy could see where the long grass bowed in waves before the coming storm. There now came a sharp whistling in the air from the south, and as they turned their eyes that way, they saw ripples in the grass coming from that direction also.
There's a cyclone coming, Em.
Quick, Dorothy! Run for the cellar!
Ears were lying close to its head, and its mouth
laid open, showing two rows of ugly teeth, while its red eyes glowed like balls of fire. As it came nearer, the Tin Woodman saw that running before the beast was a little gray field mouse, the queen of the field mice. The queen of the field mice. So the woodman raised his axe, and as the wildcat ran by, he gave it a quick blow that cut the beast's head clean off from its body, and it rolled over at his feet in two pieces.
Thank you ever so much for saving my life. Why, I am a queen of all of the field mice.
Oh, indeed.
Oh, indeed. We thought you would be killed. How did you manage to escape the great wildcat?
This funny tin man killed the wildcat and saved my life. So hereafter, you must all serve him and obey his slightest wish.
We will. Is there anything we can do to repay you for saving the life of our queen?
Oh, yes. You can save our friend, the cowardly lion, who was asleep in the poppy bed.
A lion?
Cried the little queen.
Why, he would eat us all up!
Oh, no. This lion is a coward.
Yeah?
He says so himself.
If ever you need us again, come out to the field and call, and we shall hear you and come to your assistance. Goodbye.
Goodbye. Goodbye. Goodbye. Congratulate me. I'm going to Oz to get my brains at last. When I return, I shall be as other men are.
I have always liked you as you were.
Come in,
said Oz. The Scarecrow went in and found the little man sitting by the window, engaged in deep thought.
I have come for my brains.
Oh, yes. Well, sit down in that chair, please. You must excuse me for taking your head off, but I shall have to do it in order to put your brains in their proper place.
That's all right. You are quite welcome to take my head off, as long as it will be a better one when you put it on again.
How do you feel?
She asked.
I feel wise indeed.
Oh no, I shall not feel it at all.
He took out a pretty heart, made entirely of silk and stuffed with sawdust.
Isn't it a beauty? Isn't it a beauty? It's true, but this music.
I am very grateful to you, and shall never forget your kindness.
Don't speak of it. Don't speak of it. Don't speak of it.
Full of courage,
replied the lion, who went joyfully back to his friends to tell them of his good fortune. Oz, left to himself, smiled to think of his success in giving the Scarecrow and the Tin Woodman and the lion exactly what they thought they wanted.
Who will resist the king when the king comes calling? Who will resist the king when he orders your money be spent on weapons to kill rather than health or education? Who will resist the king when the king comes calling?
Who are they? How did they get me? Play music. Stimulates the emotional part of your brain. That's what they... But no music on the Jimmy Dore Show. It's all real.
Who will resist the king when the king comes calling? Who will resist the king when he orders your money be spent on weapons to kill rather than health or education? Who will resist the king when the king comes calling? Who will take to bended knee when the king comes calling? Who will bow down and humbly offer their neck rather than follow his dictates when the king comes calling? Who will refuse to obey our sovereign lord, who claims to have won the right to rule, when he cares for no one with less money? Who will resist the king when he issues the order to arrest your friend? Who will resist the king when he orders to arrest your brother or mother? Who will resist the king when he orders to arrest your lover? Who will resist the king when he orders to arrest you?
Start from scratch.
This has been AMM Cooking with Kodiak.